I'm here today to talk to you about what's often called the secret prayers of the Mass. I should say, I'm Father Dominic Rankin. I'm the promoter of vocations for our diocese. And I love to break open things in the Mass because the Mass is one of the most important places where we consistently come back to the Lord, right? And the deeper we can dive into what's kind of been given to us in the Mass, the more we can come into that communion with Jesus, right? Which is the source of following him, whatever our vocation is. So today, those secret prayers of the Mass, there's several different prayers that the priest prays quietly, kind of inaudibly under his voice, just whispers them. They're prayers that the priest is offering to God. As you'll see, some of these are going to be prayers that the priest is praying on his own behalf. Prepare me, Lord, for this thing, whatever it is, right? Some of them, the priest is praying for everyone that's there. But he's praying them quietly because he's kind of stepping specifically into that role as an intercessor between the people of God, between the church and the Lord, right? And he stands in that position as the priest, and he's called to do that by his ordination. Now, all of us are called to offer ourselves alongside our Lord in the Mass, right? To join ourselves with the Lord in the Mass. And so these prayers can offer us glimpses and insight into what's going on at different points of the Mass. But I think there's something really beautiful about the fact that they're not kind of proclaimed in a public way, because they're just the priest praying to God. And in our hearts as well, we want all of us to be in the same way, uniting ourselves with God, turning ourselves towards God during the Mass as we can. I know distractions and stuff come up, but maybe these words can kind of catch our attention and redirect us into what's happening during the Mass. The first one happens right after the second reading or the responsorial psalm. This is right before the gospel. And there is a deacon that's going to proclaim the gospel, the priest is going to pray this prayer over him. If the priest is proclaiming the gospel for himself, then he prays the prayer for himself. Oftentimes you'll see a priest as he's processing across the altar. He'll bow down and he'll just bow towards the altar, bow towards the tabernacle usually, and he'll pray this prayer quietly to himself. And this is what it says: "Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, that I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel." Now, I think we want to, first of all, just to note, like, the priest is praying that his lips would be cleansed. This is imagery from Ezekiel, right? When the hot coal was pressed against Ezekiel's mouth to turn him into a prophet, to make him capable of speaking God's words. And that's what the priest is about to do. He's about to proclaim the gospel, which is the words of Jesus, which is the stories about Jesus. And he wants to do so in a worthy way, in a pure way, in a forthright and wholesome way. It's not him speaking on his own behalf. He's speaking on behalf of Christ. And so we ask for this gift of purification of his lips, of his heart, of his mind, so that he could speak those words correctly. Now, we all flip open the gospel perhaps every day, and we read through it, we pray through it, we meditate on it, we hold those words close to us. That's good. But in this specific moment at the Mass, there's this proclamation of the gospel. And here's where the priest wants to be very careful and respectful. This is holy ground that he's stepping onto, right? And he wants to ask the Lord's kind of preparing him for that work. All right, the second one comes after the gospel is finished. As the deacon or the priest finishes the gospel, you'll see he bows down and he kisses the gospel. He kisses those words that he just proclaimed, and he says quietly, "Through the words of the gospel, may our sins be wiped away." Same imagery here, same thing that the priest is asking, right? That purification of our sins, that of our own inadequacy in the face of the gift of God, right? That this gift of his word is given to us. We kiss it out of love, out of reverence, just as the priest kisses the altar, which symbolizes Christ and his sacrifice. So he kisses the book of the Gospels. And he asks again that these words would be an instrument of cleansing for his heart, that our hearts would be reconfigured and healed based on these words that were just spoken. I think there's one other thing to say about this, and that's simply that the words of the gospel are indicative of the entirety of the message of the gospel. And that's what actually heals us of our sins, right? That the actual work of Christ coming to redeem us, that's what the gospel contains. And so it's not so much speaking about this specific word or this specific sentence, "Lord, may that cleanse my heart," but actually, "Lord, may the entire work of the gospel, may the good news of Jesus Christ who has redeemed me from my sin, may that work be accomplished in me by this speaking the words of the gospel." Okay, now we fast forward a little bit and we come up to the liturgy of the Eucharist. after this will be after either the creed or the intercessions in any case of the Mass. The priest approaches the altar, and of course this is the time when he's gonna bring forward the bread and the wine. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, right? He praises God for these gifts. But then as he's preparing the chalice, you'll see that he takes the wine and he puts them in, and then he puts a little drop of water in as well. Sometimes this happens before Mass, but at least the main chalice, he's always gonna add a little bit of water to that. And while he does that, the deacon or the priest, again, whoever's doing this, is gonna pray this prayer quietly. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Now, I'll just point out two things. There's a lot that's packed into this prayer. One is that word mystery, by the mystery of this water and wine. Now, water and wine are not mysterious. We kind of know how they work, right? The mystery is the fact that as we mix them together, there's a symbolic thing happening. As the prayer says, may we come to share the divinity of Christ, symbolized by the wine, who himself shared our humanity, symbolized by the water. The water and wine are mixed together as a sense of like, hold on, divinity and humanity have been united. And that happened in Christ, but it also happens in you and me. St. Irenaeus had this beautiful line, early bishop in the church, and he said, God became man so that we might become God. That should blow our mind, right? That the Lord gives himself to us in a human way so that we as humans can be so united with God that we're actually like divinized or connected, transformed into something closer and closer and closer to God. Doesn't mean that I become some deity someplace, right? That's not what we're saying. But we're saying that this mystery is so rich and so deep that the Lord wants us to be so closely connected to him that he's willing to become one of us in order to bring us into his very life, into his very love. And that's what that simple gesture of mixing the water and the wine together means. Our humanity is brought to the Lord, is given to the Lord, and now what's going to happen, that's going to be transformed into Christ. Just as, hopefully, as we receive Christ into our hearts, we're transformed into someone more and more like him. Okay. Then, of course, the priest lifts the chalice. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we receive the wine we offer you. Sometimes, I will note this, the priest can say those prayers quietly, but he can say them out loud. So either way is fine, but it's not one of the prayers that's always said silently or quietly. The next one, though, comes right after. The priest bows down. He's got the hosts and the chalices before him, and he says this prayer, with humble spirit and contrite heart, may we be accepted by you, O Lord, and may our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. I want to point out the simple fact that the priest is praying for the entire group there. He's not just praying, Lord, may my sacrifice be acceptable. May I be ready to offer this sacrifice. He's praying, may we be accepted by you, O Lord, and may our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. All of us have joined together in bringing to the Lord, not only the bread and the wine, but all of our hearts. We're trying to place them on the altar at this time. And the priest bows down because he realized in his own humility, he's not worthy to approach Jesus just as a man, but he's asking for that grace, like, Lord, make me worthy, all of us. Lord, make us worthy so that we could join ourselves to this sacrifice. And Lord, allow this sacrifice to be acceptable. Of course, the sacrifice of Christ is acceptable, but we're adding ourselves to that. Lord, we beg you, we want to be accepted in your sight as well. And may this sacrifice that Christ gives to us be an instrument of what we need to make ourselves, our bodies, our lives acceptable back to the Lord. Okay. Another one here as we are preparing things at the altar. The priest turns, and usually the servers are going to come up, right? They have the basin, they have the pitcher and the towel. He's going to wash his hands. In the early church, and in some places in the church today, you'll see when they bring forward the gifts, it's not just, you know, the paten with hosts or the wine, the cruet with wine. They'll bring forward animals and fruits and vegetables and things that they're offering to the church, right? This is the time when they bring forward not just money, but stuff they're giving to God or to the priest, right? And so his hands might have been dirty. Also, if the priest uses incense, he would have just done that, right? He would have incensed the gifts about to be offered. And again, you can get either the charcoal dust or some of the incense itself on your fingers. The priest wants to wash his hands just so that his hands are clean for holding the host as it's being consecrated or for distributing communion, all of those things. But there's something more happening here. He prays, wash me, O Lord, from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. You might notice a few of the different prayers we've looked at today all have this idea of, Lord, cleanse me, wash me. This is also from Psalm 51, right? Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner, right? To recognize our sinfulness, But I think the amazing thing that happens is we step before the Lord and we're like, Lord, I'm a sinner. St. Peter falls on his knees, Lord, I'm a sinful man. And Jesus doesn't turn the other way. He doesn't walk away. He doesn't say, well, in that case, you're not able to come. You're not acceptable here. You're not welcome here. No. But we do recognize our sinfulness and we offer that to the Lord. And then he does the work of cleansing. He does the work of purifying and readying us for the great gift to come. Okay, fast forwarding. We fast forward all the way through the consecration. The prayers that the priest prays during the Eucharistic prayers are all said out loud. So there's not something that, there's none of these kind of secret or hidden prayers that are there. We're gonna fast forward instead all the way past the Eucharistic prayers, past the consecration, up to the Our Father. Okay, after the Our Father, the priest has just prayed that prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, right? And then he invites everyone to offer the sign of peace. And then he takes the host. The sign of peace is happening. The Lamb of God is about to begin, or maybe has just begun. The priest takes the host and he breaks it in half. And he takes a small piece from one part of that host and he puts it in the chalice. He says, may this mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive it. Now maybe we think back to that moment when the priest put the water and the wine together, because now something even more profound is happening, right? We're taking the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, having just been consecrated. We place a little bit of the body of Christ in the chalice. And what happens? The body and the blood are reunited. Now, when Jesus sacrificed himself on the cross through the crucifixion, his body and blood in some sense were separated, right? He lost all of his blood. He offered all of his blood for us and he died, right? He gave all of his life. When body and blood are separated, life does not continue, right? The life is totally given. Okay. But then what happened to Jesus? He was resurrected, right? He came back to life. Blood was pumping again through his veins. He stood before the apostles glorified, but alive, right? And the same thing happens in this symbolic way at Mass. We've got the body and the blood. The priest unites them back together. And there's a sense of like, oh my gosh, that just symbolized the resurrection, right? And what are we saying while that happens? Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. We're speaking to Jesus, who is present before us, alive and glorious now, right? Sacramentally present before us now. And this wondrous thing has happened where we've been able to walk with Jesus through his passion, through his death, through his offering, now through his resurrection. And now we're in these last steps towards preparing our hearts to receive him. And so it is that the priest prays, may this mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive it. Jesus Christ is the one who lives eternally. That's been symbolized by this coming back to life, so to speak, right? And we ask that same gift will be given to us. Okay. Just a few more. Right before the priest receives communion for himself, right? He's going to receive communion. In some sense, he's sort of bringing that sacrifice to completion. In the Old Testament, you had to eat the Passover lamb, right? You couldn't just have it and slaughter it and set it out and then no one ate it. There's a sense of, there's a reception that's important. And so it is that the priest is about to receive the body and blood of Christ, as are the people, right? And this is what the priest prays. He joins his hands. Oftentimes you'll see the priest bow down. He's looking at Jesus on the altar in front of him. And he's got two options for this prayer. The first one is maybe the one that many priests say. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit through your death gave life to the world, free me by this your most holy body and blood from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me always faithful to your commandments and never let me be parted from you. There's obviously that second option as well. But I want to focus in on this first one. Free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me always faithful to your commandments and never let me be parted from you. This is one of the most, I'll say, intimate moments of the Mass. The priest is looking directly at Jesus and he's speaking these words directly to Jesus. And perhaps in our own hearts and in all of our hearts, we can kind of have this same disposition. Lord, once again, I recognize my sinfulness. I recognize my need for your mercy. Lord, let my reception of this sacrament not be something that carries me away from you because of my sinfulness, right? And we want to make sure that our hearts are ready to receive Christ, that we're not in a state of mortal sin, that we've kind of brought our hearts to a place where we're just attentive and ready to receive the Lord in Holy Communion. We don't want to do that just haphazardly or unthinkingly, right? And that's why the priest takes this time. It's kind of a longer prayer, right? It takes him some seconds to say that. He says it to the Lord. And then what does the Lord say back? Maybe we ask ourselves that, right? Like, we come to the Lord with our sin. What does he say in return? Of course he wants to forgive us. Of course he wants to offer his mercy. Of course he wants to offer this balm, this gift of himself. But he does ask of us to prepare our hearts in this way too. Okay. One last thing. Right before the priest receives the body and then the blood, he says this simple prayer. May the body of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. And then may the blood of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. Once again, the missal tells us that he says it quietly. He says it just to the Lord, and he's asking the Lord once again for that gift of eternal life. I won't dig too far into this one. It's just a simple, like the last sort of thing. It's like, okay, if you're going to condense this all down to one thing, Lord, by your body, bring me to everlasting life, right? That's the gift Jesus wants to give, and that's what the priest wants to say here as this last sort of request before receiving Holy Communion. Okay, the very last prayer. Happens after everyone has received Holy Communion. The vessels are brought back to the altar. The Eucharist is placed back in the tabernacle, if any remains. And then the priest goes about purifying the vessels. And we're careful to say that it's purifying. We're not just washing things up, right? There's a sense of, okay, these things held the body and blood of Christ. Maybe there's little particles or little drops of the precious blood that we want to cleanse, right, and to consume reverently, so as not to let them get lost or just put away, right? We always house the Lord in his Eucharist, in the tabernacle. And so we want to cleanse these vessels so that they're ready for use at the next Mass, but also that we're not leaving some small part of Jesus present there and just to sit in a cabinet or something. This is what he prays, though, as he washes and then consumes that water. What has passed our lips as food, O Lord, may we possess in purity of heart, that what has been given us in time may be our healing for our eternity. I think you might notice that this refrain once again comes of like, Lord, make my heart like totally open and ready to receive the gift that you just gave. I know you're within me right now. What has passed my lips, Lord, let it be for me a gift that leads to eternal life. Again, there's that sense of reverence. There's that sense of humility. There's a sense of like, Lord, I'm sorry for my sins. Help me. And also that sense of, and the gift that you want to give is the gift of eternal life. Lord, I want to set my sights on that, not just, you know, the next thing that's on my mind or the next thing that I got to get to. Lord, let me spend this last moment just with you, thanking you for this gift, but also reminding myself of what that gift is for. I want to focus in on one word to finish us here, and that's this word, healing, that what has been given to us in time may be our healing for eternity. That word healing came up in that second option for the prayer that the priest prayed before he received. Again, that ask of the Lord for healing. Certainly, we've already seen that sense of forgiveness, that sense of reconciliation, that sense of purification. But maybe healing gets even deeper down into the heart of what the Lord wants to do. He doesn't just want to carry us into eternity, right? He also wants to heal us along the way. He wants to bring us completely together along the way, to make us integrated and whole and alive, right? That's the gift of Holy Communion as well. It's not just a gift of something that's spiritual. It's a gift of something physical and bodily. Jesus gives us his body and his blood in a physical way, in a sacramental way, so that our body and our minds and our hearts can all be united with him. And what happens when that takes place? With this deep, all the way through healing. Again, maybe it's not so much that I think we need to not just like recognize that, but to ask for that gift, right? And what are the ways we need healing in our hearts, in our bodies, in our minds, in our souls, to bring those things to the altar as we're united in the Mass, but then also to ask the Lord, Lord, do that work of healing. I can't do it for myself, but you can. Enter into my heart. I just open the door and let you in and let you do what you need, you know, needs done the most in me. Yeah, a lot to be found there in those prayers of the Mass. Thanks for sticking it out today and learning them with me. Think of them, hold them in mind as you go to Mass the next time. And just notice what the priest is doing as he's praying those prayers. They can carry us even more deeply into the mystery of Jesus giving himself to us.